Welcome back, and focusing on the issue and the situation of South Sudan, we are joined in the studio of Ambassador Mohammed Hegazi, former Assistant Foreign Minister for African Affairs. Hello, sir, and welcome to our show.
Hi, Dean.
How are you? Sir, now Riek Machar sworn in as a Vice President of South Sudan, and they said it's a sign of ending the war between the two leaders and it's a boost for the peace process deal. How do you see the situation globally?
Indeed, Dina, this is a very important moment in the history of the young nation of South Sudan. After 2 years of political infighting that led to a disastrous consequences, and definitely one while welcoming the return of Riek Machar to the political scenery and his sworn in as vice president has to recall that there is definitely a very devastating situation left after 2 years of infighting. One has to recall that the numbers that we are reading about what has happened in the past 2 years since December 2013 and the eruption of violence is enormous. 5 million South Sudanese are in dire need of humanitarian aid. 2.4 have been displaced. 750 has been already fleeing the country to neighboring Uganda, Ethiopia, Sudan, and other places. It is definitely one of the most ravaged situation and bitter conflicts that we have witnessed in Africa. So that one is happy about the return of unity, the return of Riek Machar, ushering definitely to a new challenge and a new era in the history of the modern South Sudan since it has acclaimed independence or separation from Northern Sudan or from Sudan, we know. The situation was definitely difficult in the beginning in July 2011. A country that is questing for building up its infrastructure in less than 2 years, this independence has been destroyed sort of or fall into the trap of division and conflict into a very complicated situation where people lost their homes, lost their lives, and the very young country suffered from the atrocity of almost a civil war. Although the political infighting now ending, one has to say that there is a lot that has to be done in fulfillment, definitely, of the peace agreement of August 2015 signed in Addis Ababa under the auspices of the IGAD and the clear support of the three major envoys, the United States, the UK, Norway, and the United Nations. Mm-hmm. So we are all hopeful for South Sudan to assist as Riek Machar said after he sworn in, we need unity, we need to work for our people. And President Salva Kiir echoed the same call for unity and determination to continue towards a reconciliation government that will lead a transitional period of 30 months, and the institution building should immediately start.
Sir, what's the background of such a conflict and war between both leaders? What happened? At the beginning, things were in peace.
Indeed, Dina, the SPLM was the uniting party that led South Sudan to independence, and the referendum in February 2015 led to the South Sudanese deciding for themselves to separate from Sudan. In July 2011, the start was acclaimed and everybody was in full support. the international community, the UN, neighboring countries, Egypt, the Arab world. We were all to enhance our ties and to support the newborn nation. What happened in December 2013 after the claim that a coup d'etat was attempted by the Vice President Riek Machar led to political infighting, and this political infighting in the lack of political institution that can observe opposition and different views led to a military confrontation that ravaged Juba and other cities, and in less than 1 month 400,000 people were displaced and hundreds were killed. For 2 years crimes were committed by all sides, and we've been truly following the many peace attempts, but the one that was signed in August 2015 seems the one that we are basing all our hope on, and I think if we supported the outcome. But back to your question, Dina, I think if we go back to 25 years or maybe even 50 years of fighting for separation or independence in South Sudan have led this small nation to almost a destructed infrastructure, although very rich in its oil resources and in its agriculture capability and water resources, being also one of the Nile Basin country. South Sudan was nominated to be one of the center of development in East Africa. But what happened in less than 2 years, the lack of institution, the SPLM, did not really build on. It was just a liberation movement, as they call, and it did not really reach the status that it was required to build a nation. Nation building was very important. Independence was won, July 2011, but leading the country through development process, not depending, as it happened, on international aid, international agency, NGOs, or friendly government. South Sudanese people were to build their own country, and the political system was lacking behind. Ethnic also division, then where and the other group, the Dinka, was the deciding element in controlling forces politically and economically as well as militarily. So the division between the South Sudanese people on ethnic divide was a determined factor in the calamity and disastrous situation that we face since December 2013. In less than 2 years, a country that was ravaged during the war in Sudan between North and South was followed in less than 2 years by another civil war. So I can recall the roots of this conflict into three elements. One, as I said, the SPLA, the SPLM was not really the movement that have completed its job to transfer a liberation movement into an institution. Second, the ethnic divide. Even the army was divided according to the Dinka, Nuer, and others ethnic groups. So the army as a uniting factor to any country was not the same, and we hope that this new start will lead the South Sudan to where it belongs as an integral part of Africa, and hopefully we'll see the new start as a fresh start where we will work toward reconciliation, unity, an institution building, and so on.
As you said, a war, war crimes against humanity were committed, the country was torn apart between two tribes, the Dinka and the Nuer, represented by the two leaders of power struggle between both of them. Millions were displaced, thousands were displaced from their homes, and the country plunged into a chaos. Do you believe that these two leaders can govern or control the country together again?
Mistrust is there, and it is a threat to the future. Mm-hmm. But we have seen the price of not accommodating each other, of not being able to understand opposition, of not having enough institution to run a political transition after independence. And I believe that if as regional and international participant into the well-being of the South Sudan and South Sudanese people, we should work hard to assist. The price was very hefty and very expensive to bear on each side. Everybody now understood after 20 months of infighting that unless we unite, unless we understand each other, unless we ignore as much as we can the ethnic divide, we can build our future. The alternative has been tasted, and everybody know what does it mean that a nation of 11 million suffers that much. 5 million is in dire need of humanitarian aid, 2.4 out of their homes, 750 out of their country, and I think 70% of the schools were shut. We're talking about the new generation, about the future. So the two leaders have understood that the price of division is very expensive, not on them, not on their tribes, but on also
the future of the whole country.
The future of the whole country, and that is as a destabilizing factor to the region. Countries in the region have hosted many or influx of refugees in a very fragile economic structure that
so
we have.
Can you consider that South Sudan now is paying the price for separation from Sudan?
Well, this is the decision of the people. One has to live with it and have to respect. Now we have a new nation that is aspiring for the future. We've been all there from day one to assist. Even before independence, Egypt was supporting the efforts to make the unity an attractive choice, but it is for the people of Southern Sudan to decide, and they have chosen independence. No nation building is easy. It have costed them maybe more than what should have been born after 2 years of internal civil war or political infighting. One has to recall that they have come up also with some kind of peace agreement in Addis Ababa in August 2015. Mm-hmm. So let us hope that this new, fresh start with the support of regional and international community will lead South Sudan to a new dimension, a new opening after what they have suffered during the civil war with Sudan and during the political disaccord or infighting.
Okay, so Egypt now, of course, has its own problem, its own problems. But in this, in the situation now of South Sudan, what can Egypt, in what fields can Egypt help them to support the South Sudan?
No, Egypt is determined to continue its policy to support South Sudan. And even, as I said, since 2006, we have regular support to the nation, and we have established many important projects. Four power generation units were installed in Southern Sudan before independence, and now we are training also Southern Sudanese into the generation or power station management and control. We are working also with them to establish a branch of Alexandria University in the city of Tung in Warab region with a value or with a cost of 250 million Egyptian pounds, like 30 million US dollar. We have embarked also with the Southern Sudanese government on a very important program of the value of 26 million US dollar in irrigation, in cleansing the water hyacinth, in establishing water wells, as well as small shores for fishermen and for agriculture. Also, in referring to agriculture, we have now working with the Southern Sudanese expert to create a model farm of 100 hectares to introduce new methods of agriculture. As you may also follow the very important role of the medical hospital that is run by Egypt in Juba, where 300 Southern Sudanese citizens are taken care of daily. So one can recall also a training program, which is now, I think, reached 16 training program, two each year for Southern Sudanese. While we are speaking, there is 60 undergraduate